This video is sponsored by Squarespace.
Let's be honest, buying LED lights for DIY projects is a complete pain in the ass. From horrible colors, to flickering, to some of the most janky apps that I would never even trust installing on my phone, there are just so many ways that it can all go wrong. But I am here to tell you that this $5 board off of AliExpress solves all of those problems and more. Or at least it's supposed to. I don't actually know because I just got this thing in the mail. So today we are going to test it out and see if it lives up to all the hype. So anybody who's ever bought LED lights knows that it can be a bit of a crapshoot. In my mind, there are three ways that LED lights can go wrong. The first is color, which usually manifests itself as white light that is either too yellow, too blue, or it can even be magenta or kind of green tinted, which makes it really hard to match new LED lights to existing lights. Or if you're somebody like me who films themselves all the time, it can also make your video footage look downright gross. Next up, they can flicker, which at first might not seem like that big of a deal because it isn't perceptible to the human eye. However, it can lead to eye strain, and for even some extremely sensitive individuals, it can lead to migraines. And then for people like me who like to film themselves, well, then it can lead to lighting that looks like it's better suited for a rave. And then finally, there's software. Many LEDs these days come with some sort of accompanying smart home app that allows you to control your LED lights from your smartphone or digital home assistant. You can do things like adjust the brightness, change the colors, or even create routines for your lights. For example, in my bedroom, I actually have my LED ceiling light scheduled to come on 5 minutes before my alarm clock goes off in the morning every morning, and it just kind of helps to wake me up a little bit. But this software is often buggy, unreliable, and in some cases downright dangerous. You don't always want to give some cheap LED that you bought off of AliExpress for $5 access to your entire home network. And the worst thing is that there is no way to know if a particular LED light is afflicted with any of these issues until after you've already bought it. I mean, sure, you can look at spec sheets and you can read online reviews, but manufacturers rarely list the PWM frequency of their lights or even the CRI of the LEDs. So again, like I said before, it's all a bit of a crapshoot. My solution up until this point has just been to buy high-end LED lights. My office and most of the rest of my house is outfitted with these Philips Hue lights. But Philips Hue lights are the complete antithesis of the whole DIY mentality. They're both overpriced and they're closed source. But you know what isn't ridiculously overpriced and closed source? That's right, the little control board that I showed earlier. This is an ESP32. And what it is an ultra low cost controller board with integrated Wi-Fi and Bluetooth support. And what's cool about this thing is that you can load a custom open source operating system onto it called WLED. And WLED lets you control a whole wide range of LED lighting devices. Theoretically, it allows for all that fun smart home integration, routines, and I've even heard that it integrates with Philips Hue software. So, of course, I bought one, but then I also bought this LED strip light, a 5-volt power supply, and then all of the accessories that we're gonna need to make them work together. So, let's piece it all together and see if it does. All right, so the first step here is going to be installing the WLED software onto the board. So, connect it to your computer. There we go. You can see the little LED light turned on here. And now, you just go to install.wled.me, hit install here. Select the microcontroller there, connect, connecting, install WLED. All existing data will be erased. Dun, 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 dun. Loading, loading, loading. I do wish this was a USB-C device. It's a little bit annoying to still be using a micro USB connector, but it is what it is. It's $5, so I can't complain that much. Installation complete. Awesome. Okay, so now the next step is entering all of your Wi-Fi information so that the ESP32 can connect to your Wi-Fi network. Connect. I love that this is all so well guided for you. Device connected to the network. That's awesome. And visit device. There we go. And I'm connected to it already. This is actually really user friendly for an open source piece of software. Okay, so that's great. We have our software situated and ready to go. And now we're ready to talk about LEDs. And at this point, you might be asking yourself, how does this little control board ensure that I'm going to get good, accurate colors out of LEDs? And the short answer is that it doesn't, but the long answer is that it kind of does because it allows you to use whatever LEDs you want. You're no longer tied to the LEDs that Philips or Govee or whatever third-party manufacturer decides to package with their own controller. And when you're buying bare LEDs, well, then manufacturers are much more forthcoming about stats like LED diode composition, the CRI of the light, and all those other fun geeky stats. So you can make sure you are getting whatever LEDs you need for your particular application. And speaking of specific applications, here I have a roll of SK6812 RGBW LED lights. And the cool thing about these LEDs is that each individual pixel is subdivided into four subpixels. So you have a blue, green, red, and then a white subpixel. So you get really clean and accurate colors out of these. And when I was buying these lights, I was actually able to select the color of that white subpixel. So you can match it to whatever other colors you have in the room. And the really cool thing about these lights is that they cost about a tenth of what Philips charges for their LED strip lights. So now, naturally, we just connect the LEDs to the control board and we're good to go, right? Well, no, not quite. So this is actually quite a long roll of the LEDs, and it's gonna pull some serious amps. So if I tried to connect the LEDs directly to the control board right now, well, I'd probably end up frying this little control board. So that's why I got this guy, a 5-volt power supply. This takes 120 volt AC power from the wall and converts it down to 5 volt DC power and injects it into the LEDs. Theoretically, these LEDs shouldn't flicker because they run on DC power. The flicker you get in many LED lights is caused by AC power. This is a bit of an oversimplification, but basically the power in your home is rapidly flicking on and off about 60 times a second. Supposedly imperceptible to the human eye, but you know, like I said before, headaches and eye strain. DC power, on the other hand, is not supposed to flicker because it's constant. But, and this is a rather large but, some DC powered LED lights still do flicker. Are you confused yet? Yeah, this is why it's such a pain to buy LED lights. You see, most LED lights are dimmable, and the multicolored LED lights create different lighting effects by dimming individual subpixels independently. Most of the time, they do this through a process called PWM, or pulse width modulation, which is basically just a fancy way of saying turning on and off the lights really quickly. The faster you do this, the less perceived flicker there is, and the easier it is on our eyes. So, how fast is the PWM on this board? Well, that I don't actually know and won't know until I get it up and running. So, that'll be interesting to see. It might actually even be controllable in the software. First thing we have to do is open up our little power supply and configure it for North American power. There's a little dip switch in here where you can toggle back and forth between 110 volts and 220 volts. It's funny because there's this little sticker on here that's like warranty void if the seal is broken, but then it also tells you on this sticker to open it up and flip the dip switch. Also, I got this off AliExpress, so warranty, yeah, right. Okay, so there we go. We'll go from 220 to 110. Okay, that's back together. Now we have to find a way to supply that with some power from the wall. So I just bought this little power adapter off Amazon. I think it was like $8. This end plugs into the wall. This end would normally plug into your computer or whatever, but I'm gonna use these. I'm gonna chop that off and we're just gonna harvest the wires out of there. Should really do it down on a cutting board. There we go. Be careful to cut the exterior shielding, but not the exterior. Wait. No, we'll cut the exterior sheeting, but not the interior sheeting. Sheeting, insulation. I'm having a hard time talking today. Inside, we have three wires. We have our black wire, which is our live wire. We have our white wire, which is our neutral. And then we have the green, which is the ground. Let's strip these down so that we get some bare copper on them. Boom. There we go. We have our three exposed leads now.
With the wire stripped, I was then able to connect them to the power supply. But while I handle that, why don't I tell you about the sponsor of today's video?
Squarespace. Look, it's 2023 and everybody keeps saying that you need a website. But between all the other things that you're already doing, when are you ever gonna find the time to learn to code? Well, that's the genius of Squarespace. Their website creation tool is so easy to use that even I figured out how to use it when I needed to make a website for my podcast. It's really intuitive. Just drag and drop, move elements around on the page. Basically, if you can use a modern computer, you can use their website builder. Not only that, but you can add e-commerce functionality, put up paywalled courses, allow visitors to book in-person appointments, and if you don't even know where to start, well, they've got hundreds of pre-made award-winning templates to help get you started. Check out squarespace.com for a free trial, and then when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/zachbuilds to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or a domain. All right, now let's get back to talking about LED lighting.
With the input side hooked up, now it was time to connect the output side of the equation.
Don't have my wire stripper here, so we'll just do this the good old fashioned way. Well, no, cut right through it there. There we go. So this guy right here is a DuPont crimper, and it basically allows you to make your own easy to use little electrical connectors. So you take a pin, you put it in the crimper, feed the wire in, and then crimp it down on it. Now, take this crimped pin, and we will put it in a little plastic connector. Slide that in there, and boom. Now we have a nice, easy to use wire on a connector.
While I finish crimping these connectors, let's talk power supply. It's really, really important that you properly size your power supply to the LEDs that you want to drive. The combined draw of my 5-meter strip was 90 watts, so that meant that I was going to need a power supply capable of supplying at least 18 amps. The one I actually got here is 20, so theoretically I've got a little bit of extra headroom. With the wires crimped, all I had to do was screw the loose ends onto the power supply, connect the wires to the board, and then I was ready to test.
Okay, so theoretically, this should all be wired up and ready to go now. I'll give you the brief kind of overview of how it's all set up, but I'll also include some links in the video description that go more in depth on how you can wire up your own setup, because it's gonna change depending on which board you use, which LED lights you use, and what power supply you use. But yeah, let me show you how I did it. So my white wires here are my grounds. They come off of the power supply and go both to the controller and directly to the LED strip. This green wire here comes off the LED strip and goes to the board. That's the data that controls everything. And then we have our positive red wire here. And again, we have one wire going to the LED strip and one wire going to the board. Now, all that's left is for us to plug this thing in and see if I did everything right. Maybe I should have made sure I did everything right before I explained how it worked. Well, we'll see. And hey, it works. Oh, crap. You definitely don't want to do this. You don't want to have all of your LEDs coiled up together and then have them turn on because they could overheat and potentially kill themselves. So let's just uncoil this so that our heat can dissipate a little bit easier. Let's mess around with the software and see what we can get these to do. So first things first, let's see. Can we get these to be white? Well, okay. Yeah, that was pretty easy. Why don't we adjust the brightness here and see if we can tone them down a little bit. There we go, not too bad. Let's go even farther. These are actually quite bright. And now you can see in this column here, we have all of these different effects that you can do. So let's see what Android is. Yeah, okay. I mean, that's maybe kind of interesting. You can have them breathe. And let's, oh man, that's horrible. So, you know, as you can see, there's a whole ton of different lighting effects that you can do. To be honest, I don't know how often I'm really gonna mess with any of these settings. I think 99% of the time, I'm just gonna run them in a solid color mode, but hey, it's good to know that all those little features are there. So now we have to do some very important tests. The first one I wanna do is check the white balance on these LEDs. And for those of you who don't know, you can just put your phone's camera into auto white balance mode and it'll actually read out what the white balance setting is. So yeah, we're getting a perfect 5,000 Kelvin, which is exactly what I asked for when I bought these lights. There was also a 3,000 Kelvin and a 6,000 Kelvin version, but this is what I wanted for my purposes. Now, the next big test is to see whether or not these flicker. So I've set the brightness of the lights to 50%, which means that they are being modulated down. I'm gonna set my camera to 120 FPS mode, and I'm gonna point it directly at them and see if we can get anything. This is pretty much a worst case scenario for lighting. And the best part about this is if they don't flicker, that means that I can basically make my own studio grade lights. So yeah, let's test. They don't flicker. Do you know how amazing that is for me? I'm gonna be able to make so many cool DIY lights using these now. I'm gonna do my whole studio with these lights running off this $5 board. That's so awesome. One other thing I wanna test real quick is just the app integration. So I downloaded the app on my phone and look at that. Super easy to use. It found the light right away. It's like, no problem. This is fantastic. Now, the one last thing that I wanna test is whether or not we can break into the Philips Hue walled garden and get these lights synced up with all the other lights here in my office. So give me a second, I'm gonna try and muddle my way through that. Okay, check it out. It took me a few minutes to get it set up, but it was actually remarkably easy. This is my Philips Hue remote that I use to control all the lights here in my office. Power off. And it goes off. It's actually a couple seconds behind, but power on. And then it comes on. So the way it works is it actually connects to one of the Philips Hue lights in your setup and basically steals the signal going to it and replicates it. So it just mimics one of the other lights here and it's on a slight delay. You can actually play with the delay if you want to. Let's see, what about if I set this down to every 1,000 milliseconds? Is it better now? A little bit better. It's better coming back on. So it honestly kind of depends. I'm sure I can tinker with it for a little bit and get it better. Man, I am pumped on that. One quick disclaimer I want to throw out there is that this wiring setup is just temporary. If you're going to do this at home, make sure you take a little bit more time and properly seal all your wires, crimp them better, all that fun stuff. This is just a temporary setup strictly for testing. I'm actually moving in a week, so I have some fun plans for these in my new place. But yeah, would you look at that? We solved all three major gripes that I have with LED lighting. No more crazy inaccurate colors, bit of a caveat. No more flicker, which is huge for me. That means I'm gonna make my own DIY lighting solutions for my studio. And then three, no more closed source janky software that you can't trust on your home network. Huge thank you to all my Patreon supporters, and I will see you guys in the next video. Oh, and links for everything in the video description. See ya.